Welcome to U.S. Institute of Peace. I'm delighted to welcome everybody here, and especially our special guest, Admiral Michelle Howard. I think, as many of you know, U.S. Institute of Peace was founded a little over 30 years ago by Congress as an independent federal institute dedicated to the proposition that peace is very practical, it's eminently possible, and it's essential for our national security. And USIP works to make a difference on the ground in conflict-affected areas, working with partners to equip them with the tools and the knowledge and the means to manage conflict so it doesn't become violent and resolve it when it does. And we know that all too often women are the invisible factor in looking at issues of peace and at war. And so for the last 12 years, we have really focused on that women, peace, and security dynamic. And a nod to my colleague, Catherine Kunis, who's the director of our gender policy and strategy, and has really infused our work globally with that lens. I had the wonderful honor to meet you, Admiral Howard, in Addis Ababa last November.
Yes.
When she and I were both speaking at a conference with the African Union Peace and Security Committee, along with my colleague Susan Stigand. And it was really wonderful to see your presentation on women, peace, and security and the way in which that addressed issues of great concern to the African Union and really brought forward these critical issues. So at the time, I was pleased to issue an invitation, and it's always wonderful when these things come to fruition. We are really honored to have Admiral Howard with us, who has been a trailblazer in so many ways and is an exceptional voice to be a part of what is a month-long conversation for us here at USIP to commemorate Women's History Month. And we kicked it off with a public event yesterday called When Women in War Aren't Victims. And we invite you to be a part of events that we'll be having throughout the month. So, Admiral Howard, you have an extraordinarily impressive career in the U.S. Navy. You have a whole series of firsts. You were the first African-American woman to command a ship in the armed services to reach 3 stars. And the first female admiral in the Navy, and most recently, the first female vice chief of naval operations. You're now currently the commander of U.S. Forces Europe, and she also serves concurrently as the commander of U.S. Naval Forces Africa and commanders of Allied Joint Force Command in Naples, which is mind-boggling for me to think about that array of hats. But so it's a great honor to have you here today as we have a roundtable discussion. It's on the record on women in war. And so I'll turn it over to you, and we will have time for some discussion and questions, so be thinking of those, and over to you.
Thank you, Nancy. Welcome. Thank you very much for those kind words. So everyone, thank you for joining me this morning. I think in relative terms, it was short notice, so I know some of you disrupted schedules, and there's a number of people here that some I consider family, some I consider professional friends, with some common goals in support of our service members. And so thank you for taking the time to spend a little bit of me. So before I start my remarks, let me put a little bit of this in context, as I'm sure some of you are wondering, what the heck does a sailor know about peacekeeping? Because, you know, my life of land is sort of like this. But I will tell you, my first time looking at peacekeeping like this was I was off the shores of Albania during the Balkan Wars. And women had just moved into amphibious ships. I was the XO of USS Tortuga. And we were carrying the Marines that were in reserve force in case the fighting broke back out in the spring. And so we were patrolling the Aegean Sea, got to watch the Marines, you know, PT clockwise one day and PT counterclockwise the next day. We never did have to go ashore, but that time got us very much involved in learning about the Balkans and what was going on and what our role would be. And at one point, we did go into Albania to talk to military leadership of what had just happened. And it you sit there and you go, wow, how could this part of the world have blown up and might not be aware? Well, that part of the world blew up at the time Iraq invaded Kuwait. So arguably for the UN and many of the nations that went in to push back Iraq out of Kuwait, the Balkans at that time was a sideshow that they expected Europe to handle. So after that, my experience, later on I did a West African training cruise where I worked with seven nations, and then that's part of the Department of Defense where we do training to support stability operations and to help other militaries to become more professional. And on that trip we had Coast Guardsmen who were teaching law enforcement practices. We had Marines who were teaching fundamental, basically soldier skills, and then we were providing them fundamental maintenance skills, how to take care of your everything from your people to your small boats, so that they could be stronger militaries. And then a lot of this was about who we were and this concept of civilian oversight and the rule of law is all part of the conversation when you do work like that. So, in this part of the world. Besides the naval forces, Europe and Africa, for me that includes on my U.S. side, I have CBs on the ground in Africa, explosive ordnance disposal people on the ground in Africa, all involved in training their counterparts or helping them demine parts of their countries. And you know, the CBs are a fantastic outreach mechanism for us. They're out there building schools and digging wells in many different countries. And then under my NATO hat, the current operations I'm responsible for, I have a small training unit in the African Union. I have assurance units, basically integration units, to help look at logistics support in Romania and Bulgaria. And then I'm responsible for the Kosovo force. So as the fighting broke out between Serbia, the former Republic of Yugoslavia, and all those sectors is probably the best way to put it. Eventually we got to the point where the UN said, no, we need a peacekeeping force on the ground to provide a safe and secure environment for the civilians. That literally was NATO's first venture into peacekeeping. And so it's NATO provides the framework for a safe and secure environment. But there's several nations from around Europe and around the world who also provide everything from medical support to helicopter support. So it's really a very international group. At its peak, it started off with 14,000 soldiers, sailors, airmen from across different countries and militaries. At its peak, it was at 50,000. We're now down to just Kosovo. And Kosovo and Serbia does not recognize Kosovo as a country. There's about 112 nations that recognize Kosovo as a country. So we are still underneath that UN mandate of providing a safe and secure environment. I will tell you, there is still low-level violence that goes on. My first few weeks in command, the Hungarian unit that patrols and manages the Austerlitz-Vidge and Mitrovica had a grenade thrown at them. There's, you know, my second month in command, someone shot a RPG at the parliament building when they were meeting in the headquarters or their capital in Pristina. And then there was on the Minister of Dialogue, there's a formal dialogue that goes on between Kosovo and Serbia that's managed by the EU. And then there was an attempted suicide, attempted assassination with a grenade in a hotel against the Kosovo Minister of Dialogue. So because the violence does not normally lead to casualties, that part of the world doesn't necessarily get a lot of attention. It's gotten a little bit more attention in the last month as the rhetoric between Serbia, Bosnia-Herzegovina, and Kosovo has ratcheted up. Some engineered provocations with some of the presidents of the nations calling for war, no less, again. And the Secretary General traveled a few weeks ago, and I accompanied him in Kosovo. He talked to the presidents and the prime ministers of the countries, you know, calling for basically rational behavior and dialogue, continue the dialogue. And during that time frame, the EU asked the presidents, particularly of Serbia and Kosovo, to come to Brussels to get to calmness, basically. But there's been provocations. Serbia painted a train in national Serbia colors saying Kosovo is Serbia in 28 languages and tried to run it across the border. They've been building walls, which are against the UN Security Council. And so then they have to go to the table and talk about how they're going to take down the wall. So it's not, it's a place where there's stability right now. But the two-star Italian officer who runs the operation day-to-day, I think he has the great analogy. He goes, it's kind of like Mount Vesuvius in Naples. It puffs a little while. You know any day. You just don't know what's going to set people up. So we have 5,000 NATO plus partners on the ground still doing patrols. Their biggest mission is they maintain the security of the Ciciani monastery, and then managing Mitrovica, this border town between Serbia and Kosovo. And they just do a fantastic job day in and day out. But to this topic, about 5.5% of our peacekeepers are women from around the country. So let me now talk a little bit about, if we could put up the first slide. So I'm sure most of you are experts and understand this journey the UN went on starting in 2000 with saying, hey, look, there's if we are going to get to long-lasting peace and security in countries where there's conflict, we have to understand the perspective of women. And we can get after this with making sure women are participating as the peacekeepers, making sure we're protecting women and girls, making sure that we're gender mainstreaming in the military so that it's easier to have women participate. And there was and then we got to make sure we think about prevention of sexual violence before peacekeepers go in, and then what their role is in preventing sexual violence. And so then from 2000, there was just this series of resolutions. In 2008, they talked more about the development of women as peacekeeping troops. The resolution talked about there's got to be consequences for sexual violence, where we refer, if we are aware of activities, we refer those breaches to our sanction committee and look at maybe having sanctions when we have cases of that. 2009, UN said, hey, we need to develop indicators so we know we're making progress in peacekeeping, and particularly women in security in peacekeeping. And in 2015, they said, you know, we need to develop strategies and provide resources. And so since that time frame, I'm sure many of you are aware of the journey the U.S. went on with the Women Action Plan. 63 nations have developed the Women Action Plans for Women, Peace, and Security. So there has been progress. Next slide. So for us, the 2015 National Security Strategy, and I know with the new administration this will be changing, but the words were, we are focused on reducing the scourge of violence against women around the globe by providing support for affected populations and enhancing efforts to improve judicial systems so perpetrators are held accountable. While I was on the joint staff in the time frame of 2010 to 2012, our government created a Women, Peace, and Security, a national action plan that was updated in just June of last year. And it looks at helping to protect women and girls from gender-based violence, and then also making sure there's equal access to relief and recovery in areas of conflict. Next slide. So for us, when you talk about gender mainstreaming in the Department of Defense, Secretary Panetta signed the repeal of the combat exclusion law, opening up literally hundreds of thousands of positions to women in the military. And then as you open up, and so as I pointed out, as a naval officer, peacekeeping is normally done by our folks who are in the Army or Marine Corps. And so when you open up these positions, infantry, armored, then you're opening up the possibility of having more women from the U.S. participate in peacekeeping. Next slide. So about the time of the middle, 2007, we had these security resolutions. At the tactical level, the U.S. Was on the ground in Afghanistan and Iraq. And it became clear that we had a need for all female engagement teams. And so the Army and Marine Corps developed these teams of women, trained at the basically higher end of infantry combat skills, and then that gave us access to women in these environments. So the all-female teams could go into homes, talk to the women, gather information, get a better sense of what was going on the ground, and then provide them information on where they could get help and resources. And so we had this sort of strategic level for Women Action Plan, and then it was playing out tactically on the ground because of a need. So it's interesting to me that, you can always have referendums and resolutions, but generally I find soldiers and sailors and Marines and airmen will get to the right answer because they figure out that's just exactly what they have to do. Next slide. From a NATO perspective, it was 2007 when NATO and partners in the Euro-Atlantic Council said, hey, we really need to look at UNSCR 1325. And at that point, it was already 7 years old. And they said, we're going to have to look at how we strengthen support to this resolution with partner nations. And then by 2014 at the NATO Wells Summit, the Allied leaders agreed that we've got to integrate gender perspective into our three core tasks of collective defense, crisis management, and cooperative security. And they see it as a requirement to provide a more responsive force for NATO. And that if we don't include women, it's hard for us to be ready as a force to take care of the spectrum of issues that happen on the battlefield. So NATO has been working to integrate gender perspectives in education and training and exercises. And the picture at the top is Margaret Sherman, who's the current Special Representative of Women, Peace and Security. Next slide. So the Secretary General, the current one, has said, gender equality is not optional, it's fundamental. And allows us to respond better and smarter to the many security challenges we face today. So, when you think about NATO, 1949, and the charter, and this Article 5 of if one member is attacked, then we will provide collective defense. When 9/11 happened, that was the first time in the NATO of history that they called it Article 5. And they provided, over the years, literally thousands upon thousands of soldiers, airmen from the 28 contributing nations, and then partners from around the world. One of the first groups that was in there was Norway. And my experience has been Norway is probably a leader when you look at gender integration. I mean, I think they had their first women CEO of a submarine back in the 90s. And they have had women in their infantry for decades. They too, as they went on the ground in Afghanistan, realized they needed an all-female peacekeeping unit. So they created the Jurgertruppen, or Hunter Troop, an elite special forces unit. They had 317 apply. 88 women were accepted into the program. They put together a 10-month course, and at the end, there were 13 women left who deployed to Afghanistan and could serve right side by side with their male special forces. And the Norwegians realized that across the spectrum from conventional to special forces, you have to have women to be able to integrate with what is literally half of the population, to understand what's going on, and to better provide a security environment. It just gives your team on the ground flexibility. Now, from my perspective, next slide. in the operation I've had now, that, you know, Kosovo, that's been going on, women have been part of the peacekeeping force, the safe, providing a safe and secure environment since the very beginning. But I just wanted to highlight two women we have today. One is Finnish Second Lieutenant Pirma, and she's not only a soldier, she happens to have a degree in law. So part of her job is a monitoring, so she goes around with a team and then they go to different towns and then they look to make sure it is a safe and secure environment. But she's found, as a lawyer, the country is still building itself, and Kosovo declared independence only less than two decades ago, so it doesn't have all the institutions. And EU is really the leader in trying to build up these institutions. But as a lawyer, she realized there wasn't women advocacy groups, so she's helped establish women advocacy groups, help them figure out how they can set up shelters, and then provide what the government would normally do as part of the Kosovo security force. And then on the more probably traditional military end, we've got First Lieutenant Schneider from the U.S., who's an explosive ordnance disposal. So when you look at the Balkans and the number of mines, this will be a mission that goes on for a long time. As civilians find suspicious articles, we have EOD teams that go out and just basically make sure they're either not a mine, or if they are a mine, take care of it on behalf of the population. Next slide. So here's where I am on this long journey of women, peace, and security from a military perspective. So I've come to this conclusion. Our framework has always been the three levels of warfare: the strategic level, where you've got these broad aims and objectives, and it's the art and science of war, and it's where policy and then all the levers of government sort of merge, and then you say, okay, here's what we want as an outcome at the end of the campaign. And then the tactical level is always pretty easy for people to understand. That's sailors at sea, boots on ground, airmen in the air, actually doing the individual missions that get you to that outcome. The contributing, they're the military arm contributing to get to that particular outcome. What I'm finding, it's the operational level of war, which is where I am now as the head of JFC, where we have, how do we do this? How do we go from linking these grand strategic objectives to what's playing out on the ground? Well, like I said, tactically we have not just the U.S., but many nations who figured out what they need to do on the ground. But then how do I, as a commander, when I'm planning an operation, make sure that this gender perspective is integrated into the planning? And as I've had a dialogue with my staff, it's not like there's a guide out there right now, whether it's in the U.S. or any other nation. So you see at the tactical level, good ideas are flowing up. And then we have overarching policy from NATO. You need to have your people trained. So for example, we went through our, last year my command went through its certification. We were working with Estonia for the exercise. So when we took the advanced party team out, we made sure they went through gender, women, peace, and security, basically gender integration training before they deployed. But that's just one simple activity. In reality, I think I have to be at the level of, okay, if I'm going to go into a country, and I would probably, the first thing I would do is survey my entire team and say, who speaks the native language? And yet, we do that because we have steps that remind us we have to do that. And then when we build our civil military team that goes on the ground, we'd probably look at, even if that soldier doesn't have the right skill set, they have the language. And we would make them part of that team. So do we sit there and look across our entire headquarters and go, before we go into a country, who are the women on our staff? And do we make sure that when we do planning, that there's women in the planning effort? Because based on the percentage of women on the staff, you could end up with a planning group that has no women. That perspective is not included. And so just as we're deliberate about something different, a language capability that someone speaks, we're going to have to be thoughtful in our planning process about who we are and how we bring the gender perspective into what we do. And then it gets to, how do we force generate? So if I sit back as a commander and I say, in this particular country, after we've done our cultural planning, I do need all female engagement teams. Do I have a process where I put that requirement into the force generation process so that the system says, oh, she's asking for this particular makeup, for these particular military requirements, in order to be more responsive on the ground, in order to achieve stability and security at a faster speed. All of that at the operational level. Right now, it's just, I think, commanders who, if they have it on the forefront of their mind, they're doing great things. So I know this is an area where there's, if we're going to bring the UN Security Council resolution, the Women Action Plan, to a consistent participation on the ground and a consistent looking at gender integration, it's this middle piece where I am, where there's still work to be done. And I would think, looking at our own Women Action Plan, that that might be the level that's missing in a lot of our federal agencies. How do you translate the grand language in the national security strategy to the actual things that you're doing when you're looking at trying to achieve security in a place for the goodness of the people and to the benefit of the goodness of the world? So I was hoping today we could have a discussion on this and what I see as the missing piece for where I am in the military, and get your thoughts on maybe some things I can look at, or things, or your experience sets and things you've thought about as you've worked within peace and security. So Nancy, thank you for allowing me to tee that up.
Great, thank you, Admiral Howard, and I can, your experiences and your insights on this, I think, are invaluable for moving the conversation forward. We want to open it up for conversation, but if I might, I'd love to tee us up by saying, or by asking, when you look at that middle operational piece and you identify that as the area that needs the most work, how would you describe the barriers, or why is that the biggest operation or the biggest challenge? Is it structural? Is it attitudinal? Or how do you think about that?
So it's if it's attitudinal, it's because it's based on lack of experience, and then it's also based on, I think, on how we're made up today. So when we were getting ready, we were working our way through our own response force exercise. We have a full-time gender advisor on the staff, and he was advising my deputy commander, who was playing who was going to play the leader of the group we were going to deploy. And then they were struggling with this. So in the middle of our training process, I gathered up all the senior leaders on my staff, and so they're admirals and generals in their different services in different countries. And then, you know, as I gathered them up, then we're at the table. The only woman at the table is me. And I'm at the head. But I started asking them questions. You know, what's your experience in your country with women in your militaries? And then what's your experience and what's your perspective on gender, women, peace, and security, the UN Security Council? And so first of all, there was clearly, and God bless them, they trusted me, there was clearly some angst and, you know, this is about women quotas, this is about this and that. Some of them had experience on the ground in Afghanistan, so they said, no, this is about mission. But then they also were struggling with how do we bring it up to the operational level of war. As I started to ask questions and give them my perspective, I said, look, you can't have half of the population's perspective when you're trying to do development, when you're trying to build judiciary systems, when you're trying to bring humanitarian aid to people. You can't only have half of the population's perspective when you're actually in the diplomacy piece and you're trying to set the conditions for peace. You have to have the totality of the perspective. And I said, it doesn't mean it's going to be an all women's perspective. You have to have the men's perspective, particularly if the country happens to be where the men are the power group. At that point, one of the generals, the light bulb went on, and he said, oh, I've been looking at this wrong. This is about getting everyone's perspective included. This is not about bringing women in. This is about everyone's perspective matters on the ground. I go, yes. It just so happens in a lot of places, half of their perspectives are women's voices. And we've been ignoring it. We know now that the UN has done is that when we bring women into the actual negotiation part, which is not normally the military part, so that's where folks like you come in, the resolutions tend to last longer, by years. So when we bring those perspectives in, we're getting at either facts or truth that an all-male group just doesn't see or doesn't have knowledge about. So conversation and awareness is really important to this. But being military people, we want concrete things. We want process. We want to have a checklist or a standard operating procedure. We want to understand how this should be integrated so that as you go from different mission to different mission, you're not relearning all over again. And then it's always going to be different people. So they understand the importance of it, and they understand how to get to it.
Go ahead and put your flags up, and we'll just try to catch everybody. We'll start with Tom.
Yeah, thank you very much. I'm Tom Stahl from USAID. I really appreciate what you've talked about here. I think someone wisely said, if you're not intentionally inclusive, you will be unintentionally exclusive. And I think that's part of what you're saying. You have to really actually purposely bring women in order to get that full perspective. And I think one of the other things you've shown is that too often we talk about hard power and soft power, and we say, okay, the military does hard power, and the civilian agencies do soft power, but actually the military can do a lot of soft power too, and we need to work together. And that's, I was wondering if you could talk a little more about some of the things with the all-female engagement teams, supporting advocacy groups in places like Kosovo and elsewhere. Obviously, there are civilian agencies from the U.S. government also working there, and other governments, the State Department, USAID, and so on. I was wondering how you work with them to do a lot of these things, because we're also working in that same space, looking at advocacy, civil society groups, especially working with women's groups.
So USAID will end up providing the resources, the fundamentals that, you know, the country needs until it gets back on its feet. And then when you look at the military and an all-female engagement team, they're the link to those women. Because the team on the ground for USAID might be a team that's hired locally. It might be just a few people. You guys are definitely much more streamlined than we are. You know, but the knowledge that they're there or how they get there or what's available, it's going to be those soldiers, women soldiers circulating on the battlefield, but the battlefield includes the homes, and they can go in the homes and make sure the women know that these resources are there and available, and where they have to go to get to something like medical care, taking care of a sick child. You know, they're going to be the link between, are you aware there's a Doctors Without Borders clinic over here? Because the women are not going to be able to get that because they're isolated in some cases. And then my experience has been, particularly in the last 20 years, all of the different development groups, but obviously for us, particularly USAID, are lockstep either in the CivMil coordination cell, or more importantly to me, are now at the COCOM level.
At the planning level.
So USAID has representation at AFRICOM every day of the week. Every day of the week. And every day of the week, they're coming out with, here's the different countries we're providing support to in AFRICOM. So then when we go into planning, we could sit there and say, hey, here's sort of our long-term approach. Then you've got the USAID person. They're going, whoa, 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 whoa. You may not be aware of it, but this group is pushing food supplies, you know, over here. And so can you take this time frame into account when you're doing your planning? And you're like, well, because you don't want to disrupt food delivery, you know, as you're planning to go after a particular group. So then you will lose the hearts and minds of the people you're trying to help. So having that integrated perspective is incredibly important.
Admiral Howard, my information might be a little bit dated, but a senior naval officer who helped establish the female engagement teams at Special Operations Command complained to me a few months back. He's like, I'm still trying to find out who took apart the program of female engagement teams. And separately I asked some other commanders, because I started trying to find out, and they said, well, look, they were bad for good order and discipline, and once we didn't have direct combat ops in Afghanistan or Iraq, we didn't need them. So how do you, I see the Marines have tried to bring them back in a conventional troop context. How do you get beyond the experience of some commanders who said, yeah, we had the female engagement teams on the ground, and we had pregnancies, and we had fights between operators, and they were in remote locations, and they caused problems, and you know, one bad apple who might have been responsible for that ends up tarring the whole program?
Well, when you have, when there's change, and then you might be the unique representation of a group, there is that weight of however it comes out, that's going to set the path for the future. So if individual commanders have specific beliefs, that'll be hard to counter. That said, regardless of individual soldiers, sailors, airmen's beliefs, we understand the value of what was created at the tactical level, and why I believe it, you know, if we need it again, it'll happen again. But that gets to what I'm talking about here. There was a need at the tactical level. And so you had countries, individual countries, creating these teams to fulfill that need. How do we get to, we understand that when we are planning to go to a particular region, that we take that into account up front as part of our force generation process. That we've got to pull this up to a level where whatever the requirements are, that piece is a part of that grand thing of what you look at. You know, do we need all female engagement teams? Or how are we threading the gender perspective at that operational level of war? So that if, you know, as we go through and the combatant commanders say, here's my requirements for the next 12 months in terms of, we'll talk about it in terms of medical, we'll talk about it in terms of, you know, combat arms. We'll talk about it in terms of ships. But in the end, and we'll even talk about it down to, you know, I need an explosive, a two-man dog team. And then we don't think about it in terms of gender perspective because we're pretty much gender neutral. But then we've got to step back and go, there's going to be a need on the ground for a unit or for women presence, and it's going to be in these areas. So we've got to work the process and say, how do we deliberately thread gender integration into the process?
Follow, would you like to see female engagement teams as part of the standing force?
I would like to see us get to the point across all of our countries where the women are integrated into the forces. And then you don't have to set up a separate condition. Eventually, I think eventually we'll get there. And so it's this period in between that we'll have to be deliberate in our thinking.
Thank you.
We can take a couple
Michelle
more.
Rosen. Good morning, Admiral. I'm new to this agenda and the resolution itself. And before coming here and reading through it, one thing that surprised me was that the language at the U.S. government level through DOD on the key pillar of ensuring that women are in leadership positions at all stages of leadership positions was missing when reflected internally. The pillar in our document says that we will ensure other countries have all women or have women in leadership positions, but we don't reflect that pillar on ourselves in those documents. Do you think that would be helpful if we were to do that, or do you think that the Women Action Plan and other policies already do that for us?
I would say where the U.S. military is, we're at a place where we're farther ahead. So it was, uh, I was invited to the Czech Republic to talk with their chief of defense. They're just starting to grapple better gender integration. And I was asked to talk to their parliamentarians, the equivalent to the SASC and HASC, on this topic. And then we held a panel of women of NATO. So like, we had me. We had Brigadier General Winslow, who runs the mission in Sarajevo, who's a U.S. Army general. We had Cho Chatfield, who's at the NATO headquarters, who's a Navy helicopter pilot. And then they said, well, we tried to get General Anslow. She's the deputy commander of the KFOR mission. She's Army National Guard. And, you know, and as you're sitting on this all U.S. military panel, and we're all in NATO, we're all in NATO positions, I realized it's all U.S. representing NATO because there aren't women leaders on the military side in NATO at that point, across 27 other nations. And so when I look across my own headquarters, when you look at, you know, where are the women next level down, who has the women colonels, it'll be Canada, United Kingdom, but it's predominantly U.S. So we're in a place where we have opportunity and women move up. So I would say it's less of a concern for us. In fact, NATO just hired the NATO Defense College just hired a new leader, the director, Army 3-star woman general. So I think what I'm obligated to help is, as I travel around in my NATO hat and have these conversations, really understand the dynamics in these militaries and where women are. And they're mostly at the 03 level and below. It seems to me as you get farther north into the Scandinavian countries, you know, when I visited Norway and I was in one of their headquarters, their J5/J3 is a woman 3-star who commanded a submarine. And so there are senior women in the other nations. There's fewer of them, so you just don't tend to see them. So size and percentages matter.
So we have two, maybe we can just have the last two people make quick questions,
and then
you can decide how long you can answer.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. Good morning, ma'am. Elaine Collins. I work on the Joint Staff in the J5, and we are working to update our implementation guide now that the new National Action Plan has come out. And my question to you kind of piggybacks on Michelle's. What would you need it to say or to address that the last one did not? And then I guess a follow-on question for my aide and state counterparts. Is there anything that their implementation guides need to be cognizant of that you might, I guess, see from your seat?
My question, Admiral, focuses on your request for a discussion about operational art. And as a retired Army strategist, I'm quick to grab that. The campaign plan. To me, it revolves around the vision of the campaign plan that you want to pursue and what your vision might be. It's complicated, though, when you're dealing with an issue such as this. Are you seeking to empower women? Are you seeking to include women? Because there are two different tracks there. How would you make that happen within a NATO command? This has resource implications. It has generational implications. I'd just be curious about your thoughts about what your vision for a campaign plan would be.
So two small questions.
So when you look at a campaign plan, you know, when we're working our way and we do all that upfront research and then we sort of sort through ourselves our assumptions and our constraints and restraints, but you end up with normally a very deep cultural understanding of the countries you're going into, the areas of influence. And I will tell you at a personal level, I have deployed overseas and we'll send out professors from the War College and the postgraduate school, and they'll provide us cultural training. And when I look back, in particular one deployment, I suddenly realized they didn't talk about the cultural of what women's role was and how they are and how they're arrayed and what they're allowed to do. And yet, clearly in Afghanistan, that became important. That became very important. And so how do we get to make sure that when we're looking at the culture in the campaign plan and that part, we deliberately look at where is this country in terms of demographics and then the role of women and how women are employed and whether women are in any power positions, period. And then where are women, you know, it's surprising in some countries the medical community is predominantly female. So that should be part of our cultural assessment. That will tell us when the country's in a state of conflict, what different requirements we might need for our units that we're sending in. If we need to have deliberately add the presence of women to particular units. The other thing we have to think about in terms of a campaign plan is we often talk about, you know, how do you know you finally get to security? And it's interesting to me, over my lifetime, you know, the guys on the and gals on the ground always come up with different metrics than what we come up with, you know. Well, we knew we were in a good place when the market reopened. We knew we were in a good place when the guy, you know, walked 15 miles to sell his goats. There are probably a lot of indicators that are specifically look at women and girls that we should be saying, here's a series of metrics or measures of performance that we know we're at the right level of security. You know, it's not just are the schools opening, but if there were schools for girls before, are those schools and opportunities opened again? You know, if women were predominantly going to the market, are they able feel safe and secure to go to the market? If the water supply is a river or a well, the presence of women on a daily basis going to and from the well. And then we have opportunities to create all these indicators focused on women. Because I've come to the conclusion in many of these countries, the condition of the women on the ground is your best indicator of whether or not you have a safe and secure environment. And so how do we get that perspective now at the campaign level? And you know, I'm a Leavenworth graduate. Everything I had that the Army gave me, it was lockstep right there for me to think about and include. So we've got to go back and re-wicker, and it's not for us to say the steps are in the Women Action Plan. It's how do we go back through and say we should go back through and include this thought process in our doctrine, where it's appropriate. Whether it's, you know, JP3O planning. It's not we need a separate guide on women, peace, and security. We need to include the thought process deliberately to save heartache for and not to put it on our soldiers and sailors and airmen and at the tactical level while they're trying to get the mission done. That speaks to wonderful adaptability of the military. What I'm talking about is learning that lesson so we don't have to be adaptable again. We just, it's part of how we get things done. Thank you.
Thank you, Admiral Howard. We really appreciate both your being here today and the energy that and the thoughtfulness that you're bringing this really important topic. So we appreciate very much the opportunity to hear your voice. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. Please join us for other of our Women's History Month events.
All right. Thank you, Nancy.
Thank you.